of the self. Anyone here who doesn't understand that? I see a few hands. The rest of you understand it. Who here understands it? Let's see hands going up. This realization is made possible by working with the fruit of being situated in the fixed conception of the self. Okay. No one's hand is going up. Yeah. Soul is fixed, yeah.
And body, garments, it will change.
Yeah.
So it will be fixed, and it will be, it never be, when the concept is fixed all the time.
Concept is fixed. And what's the fruit of being? Okay, it's a little tough, isn't it? Yeah? Want to give it a shot? Fruit of being is being with desire. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, I understand. But, body will be changed.
Yeah.
With the desire. Suppose that in this, my situation.
I'm going to cut you off because this is what we used to do when we had this book and we'd get a question at the end of Bhagavad Gita class. Prabhu, could you explain this sentence? And we'd say, well, fruit of being is, it's a being who has fruit of desires, and when he's got realization and the fixed conception of the self, then he's maybe no longer a fruit of being. Okay, here's the original manuscript. You can't quite see all of it, but this realization is possible by working with fruitive result, being in fixed up conclusion of the real self. And if maybe you can see there where it says with, there's a little caret, and out has been inserted in what looks like Srila Prabhupada's handwriting. This realization is possible by working without fruitive result, comma, being situated, being in fixed up conclusion of the real self. That came out in the second edition as, this realization is possible when one works without attachment to fruitive results and is situated in the fixed conception of the real self. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Does that match the intention of the manuscript, would you say?
Yes.
Okay. So, the fruit of being. Let's look at another one. The swine who eat the soil do not care to accept sweetmeats made of ghee. Any problem there? It is meant to be sort of a humorous statement, but do you see a problem with this statement? The swine who eat the soil. Do swine eat soil? No. Yeah, they bathe in it, but they don't eat it. The swine who eat the soil. Okay, let's look at the original manuscript. The swine who eat the night soil will not care to accept sweetmeats made of ghee. And you can see that the editor has put night in parentheses and put a little question mark over it because he was wondering, what's night soil? Does someone here know what night soil is? Okay. Night soil, I could look it up in the dictionary, but it takes too long. Night soil is human excrement used as fertilizer. What Prabhupada would usually refer to as stool. It's the stuff that swine like to eat. instead of sweetmeats. Night soil, and you can look it up in your dictionary. That's what it means. I guess people pass stool, and it sits there overnight, and it's collected and used for fertilizer, unless the swine get to it first. The swine who eat the night soil do not care to eat sweetmeats made of sugar and ghee. Okay. This one's good. In the prayers of Kunti in the Srimad Bhagavatam, 1.8.18, it is said that the Lord is covered by the curtain of yoga maya, and thus ordinary men cannot understand him. Kunti prays, O my Lord, you are the maintainer of the entire universe, and devotional service to you is the only, maybe, religious principle, or eternal religious principle, something like that. Therefore, I pray that you will also maintain me. Any problems here? I'll show you the first problem. That's Srimad Bhagavatam 1.8.18, yeah? Let's go someplace else. Okay, you're there, but you're supposed to move. There we go. 1.8.18. O Krishna, I offer my obeisances unto you, because you are the original personality and are unaffected by the qualities of the material world. You are existing both within and without everything, yet you are invisible to all. Does that sound like, O my Lord, maintainer of the entire universe? You are the maintainer of the entire universe, and the devotional service to you is the only religious principle. Therefore, I pray that you will also... Doesn't. Not a match, right? Anyone think it's a match? Non-match. Okay. But this verse, O my Lord, you are the maintainer of the entire universe, and devotional service to you is the eternal religious... It is a match. What does it match? Someone should know. What would be the proper verse? 1.8.18 is not the right verse. What would be the right verse?
For matching that is from which, from myself, what I've understood from reading the passage. Could this explain that God, Krishna?
No, I want to know, where does this prayer come from? Ishopanishad. Hiranmayena patrena satyasya pihitam mukham tatvam pushana pavranu satyadharmaya drishtaye. Is there an Ishopanishad here? I could look it up, actually, here. Let's do it. It's going to take too long, I think. O my Lord, sustainer of all that lives, your real face is covered by your dazzling effulgence. Kindly remove that covering and exhibit yourself to your pure devotee. Does that sound like a match? That matches. Okay, so what is presented here as being 1.8.18 is actually text 15 of Ishopanishad. Let's see what happened. Let's see, this is a little bit cut off again. The Lord is covering... you're missing the beginning. The beginning says essentially that, the Lord is covered by, that in the prayers of Kunti it is said, that's what's cut off here, that you can't see because of the screen resolution. In the prayers of Kunti, it is said that the Lord is covered by the curtain of Yoga Maya, and so ordinary men cannot understand. Let's find that. It's easy to find. You just go one verse more. 1:8:19. Being beyond the range of limited sense perception, you are the eternally irreproachable factor, covered by the curtain of deluding energy. You are invisible to the foolish observer, exactly as an actor dressed as a player is not recognized. Okay, does that sound like a match for what was stated up in the beginning? The Lord is covered by the curtain of Yoga Maya, and thus the ordinary man cannot understand him. Would you say that matches? Okay. This Yoga Maya is also confirmed in the 15th. It is said like this, blankety blank. In this mantra, the devotee prays, "O my Lord, you are the maintainer." So they've telescoped two verses into one, and they have Kunti Devi praying from each Upanishad. In the prayers of Kunti, in the Srimad Bhagavatam 1:8:19, it is said that the Lord is covered by the curtain of Yoga Maya, and so ordinary people cannot understand him. This Yoga Maya curtain is also confirmed in the Ishopanishad Mantra 15, in which the devotee prays, "O my Lord," and so on. Right? Okay. Here's another. This looks like it's 13th chapter, maybe. Bhayam abhayam eva cha himsa samata tushtis tapodant. Maybe that's 15, 13 or 15. Anyway, maybe 15 or 13. Doesn't matter. Bhayam, fearlessness, is only possible for a person in Krishna consciousness. Problem? Bhayam means fear, right? And you can't see it here because of our screen resolution, but it says bhayam, and then there's another little caret, and then looks like Prabhupada's handwriting, and there's an A there. And so, abhayam, fearlessness, is possible. The devotee demigods and the demons, asuras, once took a sea journey. On this journey, nectar and poison were produced, and Lord Shiva drank the poison. From the nectar were produced many entities, of which a horse named, which there was a horse named Uchchaishrava, and so on. Problem? What's this about taking a sea journey? Well, you see, the demons and the demigods were all at odds with one another, and then they decided to get together and sort of do a, you know, like you do Greek cruises. So they did a sea journey, sailing through the milk ocean, and on that journey, nectar and poison were produced, I guess. Because back in 1966, 1967, that story was as good as any other. But if we look at the manuscript, it said, I'm sorry, I can't see it here. But what it says is that the demigod, the demons and the asuras took part in a journey of the sea. Churning. Devotee demigods and the devote demons, asuras, once took part in churning the sea. See, but no one had, all we had was first canto and no one knew the story. So the demigods and demons took a sea journey. Okay, let's do another. There's a planet of trees presided over by Aryama, who represents Krishna. Well, that seemed plausible back in the 1960s. There were so many planets, they were all inhabited, vibhuti binnam, each one has a different atmosphere, and so there's a planet of trees, far out, presided over by Aryama. The relevant verse here is Pitrinam Aryamas Chasmi. And I don't see what's going on in the manuscript, but basically, there's a planet of Pitris, ancestors, presided over by Aryama. But the devotees didn't know what a Pitri was, so they heard trees. There's a planet of trees over which Aryama presides. Not quite right. Planet of the trees. Like Planet of the Apes, you know? Planet of the trees. Okay, this one's good. Sometimes I understand that I am happy, I am mad, I am a woman, I am a dog. These are the knowers. This is 13th chapter. Puzzling, yeah? The original manuscript wasn't really any better. You can't see it, but it doesn't tell you more. But it didn't make any sense. So sometimes we think, I am a man, I am a woman, I am a dog, I am a cat. These are the bodily designations of the knower. Does that make sense? Okay. I am mad. I am a woman, I am a dog. These are the knowers. Not as far as I know. Okay. Those are the ones in that little presentation. And there's one more that I'm going to take you through. I don't have quite such a spiffy... piece of display for it, but I'll take you through it. And, okay, at least you'll be able to see it because I can manipulate this piece. Or I should be able to manipulate... Oh, I know, I go full screen. And then I get a scroll bar. There are many descriptions of sacrifices and special functions of the pumundi, or special work in which the result of one's previous action may be applied. This is chapter 12, text 11. So I have a question for you, boys and girls. What's a pumundi? Special functions of the pumundi. Got a guess about that one? You're working on it. Special work in which the results of one's previous... but what's this pumundi thing? Pumundi or. Okay, it should be a little comma. Pumundi equals the special work in which one's... okay, so I... It didn't make much sense. So, let's see... I took it, and when I revised it, revised it, and, okay, let's make this full screen again, and made it special functions of punya, or special work in which the result of one's previous action may be applied. Does that make sense? Yeah. But our editors, one of our translators in the European BBT, wasn't very satisfied with that. He said, you know, what was this pumundi thing? So could we go back to the commentary that Prabhupada consulted, which was Baladeva Bidyabhushan's commentary, and take another look? So they did, and the relevant portion read, Agnihotra Darsha Purnamasya Adi Bir. What that means is, Agnihotra means fire sacrifices, and Purnamasi, Adibir just means starting with, and Purnamasi means having to do with Purnima. So fire sacrifices and full moon sacrifices. and saw what the actual story was or should have been, was special functions of the full moon day. Full moon day. So, Hare Krishna. Now it says full moon day, yeah? Okay. Well, that's what we do at the BBT. When we find things that are wrong, following instructions given to us by Srila Prabhupada during his lifetime, we fix them. There's a principle that the errors that even if the great sages make some mistake, their mistake should be respected. But we believe that that provision doesn't extend to the mistakes of the sages' editors. And so when they give us prayers from Isha Upanishad spoken by Queen Kunti, when they give us the planet of the trees, when they give us the fruit of beings fixed in the real conception of the self, when they give us the pumundi, then we feel we have some duty to set the record straight so that Srila Prabhupada's books will reflect accurately and faithfully what Srila Prabhupada said and what he intended. And that's what you get in the second edition of Bhagavad Gita as it is. And that brings to a close, I think. I've shown you everything I had to show you. And I'll take questions that you might have, whatever they might be. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Microphone is coming your way.
Thank you, Maharaj, for the wonderful presentation that you've given. I don't know if you're familiar with Ramchandra Prabhu's Bhagavad Gita,
mm-hmm.
The talk between the soul and God, or a mm-hmm. soul and God. And so it's a version of the Bhagavad Gita written in a way for the common person.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel this would be needed of Srila Prabhupada's other books?
I think it's fine. One time Pradyumna, our Sanskrit editor, was talking with Srila Prabhupada, and he asked Srila Prabhupada, when you finish the Bhagavatam, what will you do next? And Prabhupada said, oh, maybe Bhagavad Gita. Pradyumna said, Prabhupada, you've already done Bhagavad Gita. He said, that's only one. There could be so many. Because there's so many commentators, and Prabhupada has done it one way, but he could again do it again and explain it a different way. So, as far as I understand, it's fine for the disciple to present again the message of the spiritual master in a new bottle, as Prabhupada would say, the same wine in a new bottle, so that people will be interested or attracted and finally come to Prabhupada's book also.
Add to that, Maharaj, what is the qualification of that person to make sure the principle is kept intact?
The qualification is Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam. He has to have heard from his spiritual master, he has to have faith in the words of the spiritual master, and he has to reproduce the message of the spiritual master intact. That's his job. If he does that, then the book is a success.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Mm-hmm. Want to send that mic back?
Thank you, Maharaj. I was just wondering why you feel the need for making this presentation.
Why the need? Well, because there's a small but vocal contingent of friends who are very disturbed by the second edition, who feel that it's a great offense, who feel that it's unauthorized, who feel that it should be shunned and condemned and so on. And they've made quite an impact on the internet and have raised quite a lot of doubts, and so this discussion.
Can you tell about changes in Krishna book?
Yeah, Krishna book. The only book that I've really gone through and extensively edited was Bhagavad Gita as it is. But my godbrother, Dravida Prabhu, who's also a very senior editor at BBT, has revised Krishna book, Ishopanishad, and Chaitanya Charitamrita. And he's also recently revised teachings of Lord Chaitanya, which I don't think has been released, or it's just about, either just newly released or about to be released in a new edition. Krishna book, I should say the most extensive revision was the Bhagavad Gita, because that was the book that was done earliest and needed the most work. Later, when you get to Srimad Bhagavatam, the later cantos, we had Sanskrit editors, we had transcribers who actually could read the Devanagari and see what Prabhupada was pulling from in the commentaries. We had people who were experienced in the philosophy and who had a lot of experience in hearing from Srila Prabhupada, so it was a whole different ball game, as we say in America. And we had a lot less to deal with, a lot fewer problems. But the earliest book, Bhagavad Gita, had lots of problems. And Krishna book was the next candidate, in which the things were in much better shape, but there were problems. Mostly, there were things left out in Krishna book. There were verses that Prabhupada had translated, but the translated portion, and therefore the verse, was missing. So those were restored. I remember Urmila Dasi pointed out to us that there was one place that talked about something with snow or whatever, and it was just missing from Krishna book, even though when she listened to the tapes, it was there. Krishna book, we have the audio, because Jadurani, who was the leading artist at the time, used to make copies of the tapes. The tapes were sent to Boston. Satsarup Maharaj would transcribe them. Jadurani would make a copy by sticking a microphone next to the dictaphone and making a copy on the tape recorder, and then she would listen to that while painting. So for most of the Krishna book, we actually have the audio, and therefore you can check. And that's basically what Dravida Prabhu did. He checked the audio against the book and restored a few things that were missing and corrected a few errors. I'll tell you one of the prominent errors, one of the interesting errors. One place, what was it? I'll tell you two of them. One was that once in the province of Kashi, within the barricades of Varanasi, there was a drought and not very much rain. Anyone see the problem with that? I can't hear you.
Barricades.
Yeah, barricades. What's the problem? Once within the city of Kashi, within the barricades of Varanasi, what's the problem? Yeah, the real story is Kashi and Varanasi are the same place. Kashi is also known as Varanasi, also known as Benares. It's one place. So what was this within the barricades of Varanasi?
In brackets.
Yes, within brackets. When they went back and listened to the tape, Prabhupada said, once within the city of Kashi, within brackets, Varanasi. That became within the barricades. Another place, it said that the city of Dwarka was surrounded by cannons. And I think it was our Polish translator who was looking at that, you know, because the translators really meditate on everything, because they have to put it into their language. So they really meditate on every word. Cannons of, surrounded by cannons. You know, you can, like, picture the I don't know, one of, you know, some war, you know, maybe Napoleon and Nelson at Waterloo, or, you know, what was going on here with cannons in Dwarka? It just seemed out of place. That Dwarka was surrounded by cannons. So they went back and listened to the tape, and Dwarka was surrounded by canals. That is to say, canals. So these are the sort of errors that have been fixed in for the second revision of Krishna book. The revisions there are actually quite light, just a few percent, you know, small percentage of the book. But those are the things that have been fixed. Yes. Oh, I should explain the other books. Ishopanishad, same sort of thing. There were two editions actually published during Prabhupada's life. One was edited by a devotee named Ray Rama, and another by Hayagriva, who did it a second time. And what we found was that between the two of them, each sort of contributed something and each lost something. So then Dravida went through it and fixed minor things in Ishopanishad. Chaitanya Charitamrita, again, minor things. And teachings of Lord Chaitanya wasn't also, it had been edited earlier than Bhagavad Gita, actually, and then revised later, several years later, by Hayagriva Prabhu, not with reference to any original manuscripts. He just looked at the book and sort of smoothed some things that were not so grammatical or whatever. But many devotees felt that there was sort of a lot of flavor that had been lost in that second edition. In addition to which, there were errors because nobody'd seen Chaitanya Charitamrita, so no one had Chaitanya Charitamrita to check against when editing teachings of Lord Chaitanya. So there were mistakes, things that didn't really match the story. So Dravida Prabhu has gone through, sort of kept the best things from both editions, corrected mistakes that have come to our attention, and that's the third edition of Teachings of Lord Chaitanya, which I think will be very well received. Another question.
Mm-hmm. Maharaj, I can't, this is going by memory, but on the website BBT Edit, you've explained that there are, just now you've explained justification as to why some of the, what some of the meanings or some of the words were and why they were changed, as clearly they were the wrong word in the first place. Mm-hmm. But there are examples on BBT Edit of changes being made to words that were correct.
Really?
The words were changed, but this is going by memory, and they were ever so slightly changed.
Yeah, they were correct. You'd look at it and say it was right. When that was there and there were something correct was changed, it's usually because it was correct, but it wasn't what Prabhupada had said. So, trying to think of an example. But there are quite a number of places where you'll find that, yeah, you can say that that's correct, but it wasn't what Prabhupada had said. So the second edition came closer to what Prabhupada said. In this that website, BBT Edit, you'll see the first seven, what we call the annotated scans of the first seven chapters. I edited the book in a copy of the book. You know, I had a copy and I made the corrections there. And I thought that that copy was long lost, because I hadn't seen it for years. But one day, Dravida Prabhu opened a trunk in Los Angeles or San Diego, and there was the book. So that whole book has been scanned, and I've gone through it. Mark, and you can see all the revisions that were done, because they're there in the book. And I've gone through it making little annotations telling you why they were done and putting in like little images of what the manuscript originally said. So you can see the manuscript, you can see the changes, you can see the explanations, and you can make your own judgment. So that's there for the first 7 chapters. I'm working on chapter 8 slowly, slowly. It'll come. We'll have all the chapters up there, I hope, eventually. There's also another place where all the headline changes, you know, the ones that our friends up there are most concerned about and make the most, I don't want to say noise, they make a joyful noise unto the Lord about. We've addressed all of those separately, whether they're in the first 7 chapters or not. So if you want to know why sense gratificatory pursuits was changed to occupational duties, if you want to know why this was changed to that, you can look there and you'll see why it was taken out, that Lord Ram was of the Ramayan. What is it? Rama Shastra Pratamaham, among wielders of weapons, I'm Ram. And it says in the first edition, Lord Ram of the Ramayan was also an incarnation of Krishna. And I looked at it and I said, of the Ramayan, that doesn't quite sound right. That's like Alice of Alice in Wonderland. You know, Ram of the Ramayan, you know, he's like a book character. And sure enough, that had been added by the editor, who wanted to be helpful and explain to us who Ram was. And then when we looked at the commentaries, you know, Ram can mean Lord Ramchandra, it can mean Lord Balaram, it can even mean Krishna. And the commentators say that in this instance it means Parshuram. So it's true that Ram of the Ramayan is an incarnation of Krishna, but it's not what Prabhupada said, and it's not what the commentators tell us here. So that's an example. Another question? Yes?
Thanks, Maharaj. What was the mood of the people serving Srila Prabhupada at the time? Was it like a relationship that you'd have with the teacher? I was trying to understand.
Well, that was I gave a whole class about what the relationship of the BBT devotees was with Srila Prabhupada back in those days, but it was really fun, I can tell you that, because it wasn't that we were all sitting with Prabhupada and could probably be traveling around the world and we'd be sitting in Boston or New York or Los Angeles, but we were like the closest we felt, because Prabhupada's main work was translating his books. The translations would be sent to us. The rest of ISKCON wouldn't even know, you know, what it was, and we'd be working on it. So we felt close to Prabhupada that way, and also we felt that we were serving, you know, this most important mission of Prabhupada by turning his books out. So we had a pretty happy mood. That could be a whole few classes. Something else, yes?
Thank you, Maharaj. I'm reading Prabhupada's book, and when he normally gets the book, he normally proofreads it. Did he not pick out the mistakes, or?
Yeah, there's a nice little memory from Shrutakirti Prabhu, who is sometimes Prabhupada's servant. I'm just going to keep this up here so you'll have it. Who's sometimes Prabhupada's servant. And he commented that Prabhupada, when he would read his books, wouldn't read like an editor. You know, he'd be reading either as a preacher or as someone relishing the subject matter. But when you read as an editor, you're looking for this kind of stuff. And usually you have something that you're comparing with something. Prabhupada's just listening. So there's so many things that were discrepant. And Prabhupada apparently didn't say anything about them. He just let them go. He'd read the verse and he wouldn't say anything. Now, that applies also to First Canto. First Canto was edited also by Hayagriva Prabhu. And I went over it in 1976 and revised pretty much the whole First Canto, but especially a lot of the translations. and especially a lot of the translations in the first two chapters. And Prabhupada had read, you know, given class on those verses, never said anything about anything, but I went ahead and revised them. And then what I did, Prabhupada came to New York City, and I was working on that at the time, so I took all the revisions for the translations, at least for the first two chapters, typed them up, put them in an envelope, and put a cover letter explaining what I'd done and was this okay. And I brought it upstairs to Prabhupada's room to give to his servant, to give to Prabhupada. But Prabhupada was right there. So, you know, why have you come? And so I said, well, Srila Prabhupada, I was delivering. And so Prabhupada, you know, right there, he's had me open up the envelope. He said, read. So I began reading the verses. First canto, first few verses. And Prabhupada's listening very carefully. He said, then he, so what you have done? I said, well, Srila Prabhupada, I revised it to make it closer to what you originally said. Prabhupada said, what I have said? I said, yes, Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada said, then it is all right. So I've taken that as Prabhupada's direction on the subject, that when we make the text closer to what Srila Prabhupada said, then it is all right. If you take the point of view that Prabhupada heard these things and therefore the whole book is approved, you can take that position. It's, you know, a reasonable position, I guess, to take. Then, having made that bed, you should lie in it, which means you should accept Pumundi and the planet of the trees and the fruit of being and all the rest of that, because Prabhupada had seen it and must have been aware of it, and therefore it must have been approved. And you know, you can take that position, but then that's the consequence of that position. And it's not a position I would take, but if others want to take that, that's their, of course, prerogative. I should also point out, there's a conversation that took place in Vrindavan that's been called Rascal Editors. And Prabhupada's really disturbed because the editors have changed something without authority. And he's quite upset about it. And what it is Munya Sada Prishtoham. Munya, it says, of the sages. And Prabhupada says it should be O sages. That's the mistake. And he really goes on about it. And you know, people have also, you know, brought this up as like Exhibit A and so on. If you go back and listen to the conversation, you'll see it mentioned that this was an old printing. Between the time, and you know, this is India, Vrindavan, and books didn't quite get over to Vrindavan real fast. Meantime, before that conversation had taken place, the BBT editors had found the error, corrected it, and published a revised, corrected version. So Prabhupada hadn't seen it, and he was looking at the old edition, and therefore he was disturbed. But if he'd read what the rascal editors had done meanwhile, there wouldn't have been a problem. Yes?
Marge, on that note of Srila Prabhupada not picking up the mistakes in the translations. I've been told that there are some mistakes in the first six chapters of the Bhagavad Gita. And as they were typed by Srila Prabhupada himself, where do we stand with those corrections?
There are mistakes in the first six chapters. There's some place, I think, where Prabhupada... I'm trying to remember. Our general policy is that when it's Prabhupada's mistake, we sort of leave it. That's generally what we do. Sort of depending on the category of the error also. But there are things that we just leave and say, well, that's what Prabhupada said. But we have no respect for the mistakes of the editors.
Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna Maharaj. I just have a question about diet, because one time Prabhupada was fly by airplane and he pleased to drink 7-Up and he drink...
That seems pretty off topic, doesn't it?
Yeah, and I want to know, because he told this because of problem with stomach, and can you tell more about this, what happened?
I think this is a crucial question, even more crucial than the editing of Prabhupada's books. The 7-Up company had a slogan that they printed on their cans back in the 1970s. You like it, it likes you. Apparently Prabhupada liked it. That's all. Okay. Do we stop here? I guess it's time for the RT, yeah? I think we can stop here. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Samaveta Bhakta Vrinda ki jai, Gaur Premanande.
The Sunday feast talk this Sunday starting at 4:30 p.m. So please come if you can. Hare Krishna. Jagannath Baladev Lady Subhadramayi ki jai. Thank you.